So today we're going to start talking about biological databases. There are a number of articles and web pages that are good to read, that are in the reading instruction for this part. And the goal of this is first to understand what is actually a database and how is it organized and what type of database exists. Secondly, we will go through a few of the fundamental databases and in particular the interfaces to these. And we will start with what is database? So database is some type of structural data. It can be different types, including so-called flat files, which is just text file, relational, which tells how things are related to each other, and other types, another object-oriented, etc. So for instance, Google has the database of all web pages and how they're related to each other, and that's what you use when you do a Google search. And often you want interface, you want to query a database, you want to ask it something and get the information back. And the idea is that by having this structured data, you can get this query results very fast. So when you do a Google search, you have the reply in a few seconds or a few milliseconds. And but if you would have to go through all the data, even for the fastest computer in the world, it would take hours and hours and days. But that's because it's not structured. So a database is, as I said before, a structured collection of information. The basic unit is some kind of record or entry that contains information. And this record consists of different fields that have some predefined data in it. It can be empty, but the whole idea is that it has some kind of structure in it. For example, if you take a protein database, the entry wouldn't contain a single protein normally. And the fields could contain information such as the name of the protein, the length of it, the amino acid sequence, or the structure of it. So that in general, you could say there are two types of databases in biology. There are primary databases that contain data submitted by experimentalists. It's often annotated in some way by computational or by manual methods. So these are examples of databases are gene bank, PDB for protein structures, etc. So there are experimental data that is then later can be used by computational scientists. And then there are derivative databases, there are secondary databases that actually are controlled by, that are derived from this primary data. So therefore, it could be even for protein sequences, it could not be, if you don't have a sequence, it could be the information obtained from the sequence database. So that's actually, that is UniProt, that is trying to have additional data added to the information about the protein, not just the sequence. There are many of these, and there are many developer methods of making better with these databases. This is a big part of bioinformatics. So in short, a primary database, it's a database that has databases collected and they have the information to get to it. So you have sources, one or two or three different sources, three different experimental groups that put it there in some kind of format, some basic checks, and then you have an access to it. While the derived database often integrate databases from the primary databases together and have a derived database, and often there's a web access to that. So yes, for example, we could think about proteins. Another database, a flat file database, could be that is the old traditional form of database could be a telephone book. So you have the S Klaus has a phone number and address, and the M Mouse has another phone number and address. So if you would search for a name, you search for Klaus, and you find the name Klaus, and you find his phone number. Or you search with all names that have an M in it, you find Emma Mouse and a Mole Man, and you find the address and the phone number of these people. Or you search for a phone number, and you find a name. Similarly, we have a gene bank database, which is, contains the DNA sequences. You have here locus and the information of it. You have length of it. You have the type of DNA or RNA in this case. You have definition, which is something derived from it. You have an accession number, which means that this is has a unique accession number, so I can link to it directly from other databases. It has a version, which is U49845.1 in this case. You have a source, organism, etc. So contains organism information. A relational database is basically two tables linked together. So you have a protein code and name, this is P1001, 002, etc. Some name, length, and species. And then you have a sequence, this is another link. So if you take, okay, I know, so for hemoglobin, I find it's P0 in bovine. I find it P0, P1001, and I go to this query and I find P0001 has a sequence MDR, TTT, etc. So I have, you can make complex queries in this relational databases that you can ask for the primary key and secondary key in front of together. And the whole idea, so this is often using a language called SQL. And the whole idea is that actually these keys and searches can often be made very, very fast. So you can find the sequence of the database and you can find there's something else that links together because you have these keys that link things together. And you can find a subset of the databases. For instance, all sequences that are human is quick to find. You can extract it. So these datas are normally stored in data warehouses, so that's kind of big computer and have it all together. And there are people, the data sources that are entering the databases, they use to access it. Nowadays, the normal user accesses the web interface, but there are also ways to access it by computer programs directly or by other ways. So often you have a front end. So for this is, for instance, the transport DB, so the database of transporting proteins. So here you have the genome data, you do some analysis of it, so this is the derived database, you search against it, you find it, you have some programs that are analyzing it and deciding if a protein or a part of the complete genome is transport database. You put it in a transport database, and that works annotated in different ways. And then you have an interface, in this case written by PHP, and you have a web browser that you can use for access data. So you can, for instance, look for all glutamine transporters, and you get a list of them back. And you can search for protein sequences and structures, etc., etc. So, in biology, there are many different types of database. You see, there are nucleotide, proteins, plants, organelles, structure, etc. So, this is just a very, very rough overview. There's no way we can go through everything in this course, but we will have a few looks at some examples of the most important databases. And these, of course, are so in entries, they have divided types of organelles. So they have a nucleotide, protein, genomes, structure. So, that's also proteins mainly. Taxonomy, organisms, mutations, genes, groups of genes, and homology, chemical compounds, chemical substances, genome projects, so the genomes are not finished, gene types and phenotypes, gene clusters, protein domains, 3D domains or structures, marker and mapping data, population data sets, expression profiles, data sets, cancer chromosomes, etc. So you have a lot of different databases and they are often accessed from different places. And often you want to have a way of describing the content of the database. And this is an ontology. So this is just an example of a proposed ontology for multiple sequence alignments. So that's how sequence align together. So you have that's the top thing, you have sub-alignments, you can align different sequences into columns, and you have residues, amino acids, structure, etc. So you can have a way of describing data. So often you need some kind of description, which is called an ontology, to describe how different things in database are related to each other. So there are a number of major database providers. In Europe, it's EBI, European Bioinformatics Institute, that is located in close to Cambridge in the UK. And then there are the National Center for NCBI, National Center for Biotechnology Information, that is located in the US. And there's also DDBJ using DB database more in Japan. So one fundamental question when you access a database is actually to think about it. It's like, what is the quality of the data? How are things entered? Is there some quality checks? What are the evidence codes? Is it just automatically annotated? Is it manual? Has someone done experiments, etc.? How new is the data? It's a general problem that it's actually quite hard to get funding for maintaining a database. So most databases, you can write a paper about it, you do it, you publish it, and then immediately it just dies because there's no people, no resource to maintain it. And also not agreed because it is a data secret. Do you actually have the right to use it? It could be patented data. It could be methods that you can use for your program, but you can't distribute it further, etc. And also, is the data redundant or non-redundant? So for instance, there are many protein sequences that are identical. Are they added once or several times in the database, etc., and so on, and how it is updated. So there are a lot of things to think about when you look at a database to say, well, is this really the right database I want to use, or is it something else that's better, or do I need to create my own one?